Hello, students. A few months ago, the New York Times held a competition for adolescent kids. Their aim was to challenge the way media and adults see their generation and to create a more accurate and stereotype-free portrayal of Generation Z, Gen Z, Gen Z, Gen Z, Gen Z. The contestants had to take photos that showed different parts of their lives or the lives of teenage kids around them. The motivation was to bring new and unique perspective to this group of young people. Over 2,000 students participated in these competitions and they submitted photos in different settings like teenage kids are having a nice time in their classroom, enjoying parties, swimming pools, and they are playing in the grounds. Some photos show teenagers spending time with their pets, friends, family members, doing their home tasks, busy in makeup, and playing computer games. The students also captured images of teenage kids participating in sports, running, jumping, singing, group studies, taking selfies, and even protesting for some social issues. But interestingly, on and around 70% of the submitted images showed that teenage kids engrossed in their mobile phones. In their statements, the Time reporters claim that the students describe their mobiles as either their friends, family, enemies, or addiction. So why I am sharing this information with you is because it leads to our today's topic for discussion, which is about the stereotypes beliefs we often cling to and why it's important to break free them to succeed in life. Well, stereotypes are generalizations we often make about groups of people or things without really understanding them. These stereotypes beliefs can limit our ability to clearly visualize the truth and make ultimate decisions. Who knows, you might miss out on opportunities or make wrong decisions because you don't have the clarity. Time is moving fast as always, and in this fast-paced world, it's important to keep on challenging your own beliefs continuously and being open to new ideas which you can absorb from your surroundings if your eyes are not closed. Because we all have short amount of time in our hand, and in this limited time frame, it is important to pivot timely and make necessary changes whenever possible. Okay, so this session has been divided into three sections, each with a specific topic. The timestamps for each sections are also provided below, allowing you to watch or skip to the sections that interest you most. However, it is just a little bit of advice that you better watch the entire session, okay, as we strongly believe that you will automatically benefit from the information presented here, okay? In the first two sections, I will present some empirical research findings related to this topic. These research findings are based on data and evidence that have been gathered and analyzed by researchers primarily from Chicago University, Pittsburgh University, University of British Columbia, and Oxford University, respectively. I have also included citations for the research article so that you can delve deeper into the topic if you are interested. Apart from that, I will also draw upon my few personal life experiences, my life learning, shared with you with more practical insights. And I hope that all these suggestions will help you become more aware of potential threats you may face in the near future. Substantial research studies that have explored the beliefs held by adults regarding teenage kids. The findings of this study suggest that adults often perceive teenagers as being more prone to engaging in risky behaviors than younger children. Additionally, younger adults are more likely to disregard the advice of their parents, teachers, and to neglect their schoolwork. Furthermore, teenagers are believed to be more susceptible to negative influences from their peers and from popular media. These beliefs are often shaped by personal experiences or cultural norms which can lead to negative stereotyping of teenagers. For example, the behaviors of being moody, staying up late, and spending a lot of time looking at mobile devices are often stereotypes as a teenage thing. Since the use of mobile devices is become increasingly common among young teenagers and can be seen as a way to stay connected with friends and peers. However, these behaviors are not necessarily exclusive to teenagers only and can be found in people of all ages, right? So instead of being judgmental, it is important to understand that the convenience and accessibility of online networking is a universal aspect of modern technology use and not just limited to teenage kids only. Well, this can have serious negative consequences as well, particularly when it involves family relationships. Let's say if your parent or any parent holds stereotyped beliefs about their teenage child, it can lead to changes in the dynamics of their relationship. Parents may feel the need to exert greater control over the child's behavior and overcorrect them quite frequently, potentially leading to power struggles and sometimes even strong conflicts. As a result, the teenage child may feel misunderstood and resentful against their parents, and the relationship may become strained. In the worst case scenario, this can lead to damage parenting relationships, which can even be difficult to repair in the future also. So, recent study from CPTC co-founder Dr. Carol Ford and faculty Dr. Victoria Miller showed that parents with positive views about teens have better communication and report better well-being. But when parents hold negative stereotype beliefs about teens, it can harm communication. Making new friends can be a challenge for many teenagers, especially when they find themselves in a new and unfamiliar environment. For example, as an exchange student, adjusting to a new country, culture, and language, you may find it particularly difficult to build connections with your classmates, batchmates, friends. Now, in this case, stereotypical beliefs and negative attitudes can additionally complicate this challenge, especially if you hold biases or preconceptions about the people or culture in the new environment. If you hold negative beliefs about the local culture, naturally, you will be hesitant to engage with others and struggle to connect with people from other culture. Alternatively, you may worry that people won't accept you because of your cultural difference. To overcome this challenge, it's important to step outside of your comfort zone and participate in new activities or groups. This could include joining a sports team, volunteering, or attending social events. But if you are an introvert in nature, then initially you need to force yourself, keep pushing yourself out of your comfort zone. But it's important to not to stuck in the mentality of why I should do this. Now, in this context, I want to make you aware of the prevalence of social isolation and loneliness, which have become increasingly common and can have negative impacts on both psychological and physical health. There are a wealth of medical studies over the past decade that has shown that the number and quality of your close friendships is the single best predictor of your psychological and physical health as well as your well-being. So how do you find friends, make friends, and develop strong relationships? Well, a recent study of over 5,000 people found that it takes a minimum of 34 hours of commitment to transition a new acquaintance into a friend, and at least 6 months to turn an average friendship into transforming something solid. You have to find a common ground, and sometimes even working together also offers a great opportunity. When you are working together on a same projects in a group, completing tasks, following up and following through. And in this way, over time, you're also getting to know other group members closely. Well, I am not saying that you will become close friends with everyone in the group right away. But what magic will happen is you may begin to realize that you all share almost similar problems and challenges, which is the important step in developing empathy and understanding toward each other. This can be particularly helpful in building a strong bond, you know. You will feel that you are not alone in your experiences, and you can relate to others on a deeper level, which eventually opens up opportunities for many of you to offer help and support to others who may be going through similar struggles. Indian parents and students hold this superficial conviction that their life will be complete or their child life will be complete with success and happiness once they achieve the feat of clearing the IIT entrance exam. Well, to be honest, I don't have any information regarding previous decades. I can only speak to the current situation of this decade. I can say this because I am also an IITian and I have completed my graduation from IIT Kanpur, which was still now my second home. So very few can share the perspective which I am going to share with you now. So as I mentioned, I can only speak about the present scenario, and based on that, you can speculate what may happen in the near future, because the future can only be predicted based on the data you have in your present, right? Trying to provide the clarity on the current situation, it's important to understand that simply clearing IIT does not guarantee a stress-free career or ensure success. It is not like there is a magic stick that can be waved to guarantee a successful and lucrative career. In fact, a significant percentage of BTech students do receive termination letters during their degree process. But there is a different story, and maybe I will make a separate video session for that on how to cope up with that situations. But having a dream that graduating from IIT will guarantee success is not at all true, at least in this decade. Well, I am not saying it is completely false, it is partially true, but the percentage of graduates who actually benefited from the exposure provided by IIT is decreasing day by day. While graduation from IIT may open doors for very few, but current statistics demonstrates that over 40% of IIT graduates do not even benefit from that exposure. Some are not even able to secure their desired job through campus placements, and many of them even avoid sitting on campus placement altogether. Many opt out for preparing for UPSC exams in Delhi or pursue higher education abroad. In all these cases, the IIT degree holds little significance, because even an average student from a local college can still appear for UPSC exam, isn't it so? And for higher education abroad, one needs to clear their exams like GRE, TOEFL, IELTS, and several other norms are there. Thus, while graduating from IIT may provide exposure, it does not guarantee success. And again, that issue is appearing in front of you that you have to utilize this exposure very wisely. And also, sometimes it is a matter of luck. So the fundamental takeaway lesson from here is to prioritize learning over just getting into an engineering college. By solely focusing on the goal of getting into college, it's natural that you will miss out on the world around you and do not develop any problem-solving skills and coping skills that are crucial in your career development process. It's important to put 100% effort into whatever you are currently doing, you are currently learning, and not be discouraged by the failure. You may fail, but the process of learning itself will help you in the long run. Because once you have developed a strong habit of learning, nothing in the universe can stop you from creating something significant. Thank you.